body lay. Light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. For I am his, and he is mine, bought with the precious blood.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You may be seated. God's word from Acts chapter 13, beginning with verse 1. Now in the church at Antioch, there were prophets and teachers, Barnabas, Simeon called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manaen, who had been brought up with Herod the tetrarch, and Saul. While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, "Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them." So after they had fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and sent them off. This is the word of God. Please join me in making confession of our sins using the prayer which you see on the screen. O Lord, you give us your gifts through the preaching of the word, baptism, and the Lord's Supper, but we sometimes fail to give you thanks and credit for making us a chosen people, a royal priesthood, and holy nation belonging to you. You give us evangelists, pastors, and teachers, but we often fail to declare the excellent qualities of God and live the better life of Christian love. You give us direction and example in your word, but we're tempted to undervalue your part in the divine call and use worldly qualifications to evaluate candidates. You speak to us through those you send us, but we're tempted to see, hear, and talk about the weaknesses of the person you sent rather than your word and your work which you are doing through them. Forgive us. Forgive all our sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ Jesus, I forgive you all your sins in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. It is time for the children's message, So children, come on up. Very good timing. Come on up. All right, good morning. How are y'all today? Fantastic. Well, I like seeing your bright, shining smiles today. That's awesome. It's good to have you here. Today, we are celebrating Easter still. Wow. We are still celebrating Jesus dying on a cross to take away our sins and Jesus rising from the dead to give us forgiveness and righteousness and show us that he's victorious over sin and death and the power of the devil. You know what that means? Freedom. Yeah. Freedom from sin, freedom from death, freedom from the devil. And it's freedom to serve, freedom to love God, freedom to love others, freedom to serve God and serve others. So yeah, freedom is a good answer. There is freedom that we have been given as a free gift, from God. And that's an exciting thing. So today we're still celebrating Easter. And we have this phrase that we use to help remind us what happened on Easter. And we say, Christ is risen. And what does everybody else say? That's exactly right. He is risen indeed. So let's do it. And you do it nice and loud. You do it nice and loud too. He is risen. Good job. Yeah, and you can add the alleluia too. In the church I grew up, we didn't add the alleluia. I don't know why. I think we were sad. We were the sad Lutherans, as Garrison Kaler said. So we were not really sad. We were excited too. We just didn't say the alleluia. I don't know why. It just is. But we have a lot to celebrate today, and that celebration continues. And today we're going to be talking, at least with your parents, about something called the divine call. The divine call. And what that's about is how Jesus instituted, well, first of all, let's just say, part of what we learn in what we've learned is we have this freedom, right? You got that part right, that we have this freedom. And we have a fancy word for it we started to talk about a little bit last week, and it's called how we are justified. It's just as if I hadn't sinned at all in God's eyes because of who Jesus is and what he's done for us. It's just as if I'd never sinned. My slate is not only wiped clean, it's filled with all the good things that Jesus did, and it's placed in my account so that when God looks at me, all he sees is all the righteousness of Jesus Christ, which is a really great thing, a really great thing. And God made sure that that word, the word about Jesus, the gospel, would be preached all over the world. And part of the way he does that is through everybody here. We all have that responsibility. But when we do it together, God has instituted the office of the holy ministry or of the pastor. And so there's a pastoral ministry that happens, and God is the one who calls him. The Holy Spirit is the one who guides and leads to pastors coming and serving at a particular place. But he works through the people in the congregation in order to do things like praying and worshiping and fasting and looking at qualifications and gathering information and even electing and ordaining. All those things work together. God uses those human means to actually make a divine call. And that's a great thing. It's just like baptism. It's just water, but it's not just water. It's water connected to God's word that also gives us forgiveness and freedom. All right, well, let's bow our heads and say a prayer. Dear God, thank you. For your great love for us, that you sent Jesus to die on a cross and rise again to give us freedom. Freedom from sin, freedom from death, freedom from the devil, and freedom to serve. Thank you also for sending us pastors to share that word, to baptize, to give the Lord's Supper and lead your people and equip them for works of service. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now you guys get to go have fun in the back and learn more about Jesus. Have fun. All right. And learn more. All right. The rest of us, let's stand and sing our next hymn. Or song.
The moon and stars, they went. The moon and stars, they went. The morning sun was dead. The Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, his blood poured out for us.
Seated. And if you would please find your info slip, it looks like this, and if you could go ahead and fill that out, at least place your name on there. If anything's changed or if you have any prayer requests, we'd love to have those, or Thanksgivings, please let us know about those, and then be ready to place that in the wooden box as you leave today. Today we're going to be looking at the divine call, and maybe you're wondering, why is it that we do what we do when we call a pastor? Why Why do we not have a bishop or a higher up that just sends us somebody? Why is it that the district just doesn't pick somebody and send them to us? Why is it that we don't have a group of people, a search committee, that goes and goes to different churches and checks out pastors and then hires them to come and be a pastor at our congregation? Why do we have what we call the divine call? And how is that different from those other methods of calling a pastor? Well, in order to understand that, we first have to talk about you, about who you are. And this is really important. This is something that was lost in the early church. Well, not in the early church, in the medieval church. So it was there in the early days when they were meeting in homes and in catacombs and when the church was in distress because there was persecution and martyrdom, people being killed because of their beliefs. But then as time went on, things changed and systems of bishops came, and then there was a reaction to that in the 1600s, 1500s, late 1500s, early 1600s, and people went like the opposite direction, but not us. The main part of the Reformation looked at this next passage and believed how I summarized it here. God chooses us, you and me, for important roles, for intimate connection with him, to declare the good news of the gospel and to live the better life of Christian love. So this is a passage that Luther saw and went, wait a minute, this has been missing. This has been missing in history. This is missing right now. And said, we need to bring this passage back to people's minds. So 1 Peter 2:9, however, you are chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, people who belong to God. You were chosen to tell about the excellent qualities of God who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. He's not talking about pastors or evangelists or teachers or prophets or apostles or disciples. He's talking about you, about all people, all Christians. All Christians are indeed chosen people. You didn't choose Jesus. You didn't decide, well, maybe you said a prayer and asked Jesus to come into your heart, but if you prayed that prayer, he was already there. He was already there. And he's the one who chose you and gave you his word so that you would pray that prayer, so that you would commit your life to Christ Jesus. God is the one who works first. You didn't choose him, he chose us. We love God not because we just love God and we're so good, but because he loved us first. That's why we love God. So God is the one who does the choosing. And what has he chosen us for? Well, first of all, for this great status that we have as a royal priesthood, a holy nation. We are the priesthood of all believers. We are a holy nation. And when we say holy nation, we're not talking about the United States of America. We're talking about God's people, God's church, as they speak the gospel, because that's where the power is. The power is in the word and in living the good life that the word teaches us to do. Without the word, it all falls apart. And if you lose the word, if you lose the gospel, you have no church, you don't have true believers in Christ. And God's work doesn't get done, or his main work of justifying sinners and making it as if we have no sin through Jesus Christ and what he's done for us. So all these are gifts from God. And we belong to God as a result of this. We don't belong to ourselves. We belong to God. And what do we belong to him to do? We have freedom, but we have a freedom not just from things, but a freedom to do certain things. And that is to serve God, to love God and love others, to serve God and serve others. And all of this, to tell about the excellent qualities of God who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. And, we just had this meeting and somebody talked about, how we need to do more things that we enjoy doing, but invite Jesus to be a part of that. And invite Word of Life, to let people know who we are and where we go to church. So it's like, keep on doing the things we're currently doing, the things we enjoy doing, but let's bring Jesus into the picture. Let's give God credit. Let's let people know and maybe invite other people Word of Life people with us so that they get to know more than just one person that's involved in that good thing. It's sort of like, well, let's have fun, but let's invite Jesus too. Let's have fun, but let's invite Jesus too. God works faith in us through the preaching of the word. That's how we get to know Jesus. That's how we have faith. Faith comes by hearing the word of God. Romans 10:17 says, so faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. That word is powerful. That word is powerful. And the context here, it applies to the word that you speak, but the context here is preaching. And how will people know unless they're sent? Unless they're sent. So it's talking about those who are sent to preach, which would be, you know, pastors, evangelists, missionaries, and such, so, and teachers. God causes us to be born again through baptism. So the second great gift, besides his word, is baptism. And baptism is really nothing more than the word plus water. God's word, how Jesus instituted baptism in Matthew 28, using his words and adding water. And the word is what adds the great power to that water. God causes us to be born again through baptism. Titus 3:5, he saved us, but not because of anything we have done to gain his approval. Instead, because of his mercy. He saved us through the washing in which the Holy Spirit gives us new birth and renewal. God causes us to be born again in baptism. 1 Peter 1, verse 3 says, baptism, which is like that water, now saves you. And it's talking about the water in the flood, Noah's flood, right? Or God's flood that killed the evil people, and the world had gone mad and was just going crazy. And if he hadn't done that, Noah and his family probably would have been lost. And so he wipes out most of creation, most of humanity, in order to save humanity. Fortunately, he said he'll never do that again. And instead, the wrath, the righteous wrath of God upon sinners fell upon Jesus. And he absorbed all that and suffered that so that you and I wouldn't have to. And we receive the benefit from that, from being baptized into Christ's death and rising to new life in Christ Jesus. So I could have added Romans 6, but didn't have time to do all of them. But baptism now saves you. It saves you not just by itself. It's not just a ritual that does that. A lot of people mistake what we believe and how we interpret the scripture by thinking that somehow we believe the ritual does something. Rituals don't do anything other than they provide a visual cue, a visual aid, if you will. It's not the ritual. It's the fact that God has instituted baptism, well, Jesus has, and he's done it where he's connected water along with his word. And that word is what gives the water the great power to save. And even that wouldn't work if Jesus hadn't died on the cross and rose from the dead. So it all becomes dependent upon what Christ did and coming back to life. Baptism is a means of salvation, not the means of salvation. God gives us life also through the Lord's Supper, through the Lord's Supper. John 6, 53 through 56, Jesus told them, I can guarantee this truth. If you don't eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you don't have the source of life in you. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood have eternal life, and I will bring them back to life on the last day. My flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood live in me, and I live in them. Do I understand everything I just read? No. But I believe it. You don't have to understand it. It wouldn't be a mystery from God if you understood it all. But I know what God's word says. God's word says that Jesus took bread and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and said, this is my body. So I believe it. He took wine. Well, it doesn't say wine, but it's cup, and they were doing Passover, so it would have been a cup of wine. You don't drink a cup, you drink what's in the cup. You know, so that cup or that wine is the blood of Christ, he says, Jesus says, to his disciples. I don't question what Jesus says. I believe it. I don't try to figure it out. I just believe it. I say it's a mystery. And it's even more mysterious that somehow or another that it gives forgiveness of sins. How do I know that? Because it says that. For the redemption of sins. For the forgiveness of sins. And here it says it gives us eternal life. Wow. All this from little thimblefuls of wine and little, you know, they seem like facsimiles of bread. They're really bread, but, you know, it's just, you know, this little paper bread that you eat. How does that work? I don't know. It's a mystery. It's God. He's the one that infuses that meal with this great power. With this great power. It gives us forgiveness and life. It unites us in Christ. Just like baptism unites us with Christ. And where Christ is, there is nothing but forgiveness, righteousness, and life. So we are connected in His power and receive His life, His righteousness, His forgiveness, His power. And mystery of mysteries, Christ entrusts the office of pastor with those three gifts, with the gifts of the Word, the gifts of baptism, the gifts of the Lord's Supper. You could also add absolution, the forgiveness in that as well, because that's a mystery too. How can somebody wave his hand, don't even have to wave his hand, and says, I forgive you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and it be from like Jesus himself? I don't get that either. But it's true. Why? Because God says that whatever you release on heaven, or release on earth will be released on heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. It's amazing to me. It's a mystery, but it's true because Jesus says so. And 1 Corinthians 4:1 says this, people should think of us, this is Paul talking, along with his companions, as servants of Christ and managers who are entrusted with God's mysteries. And what are those mysteries but God's word, baptism, Lord's Supper, and maybe holy absolution or forgiveness. So, servants, that's the main thing. Pastors are servants of Jesus Christ. We do what Christ says that we should do, not what people say we do, not what a select group of a congregation tells us what to do, but what Jesus tells us to do. And it needs to be from Scripture, again, because that's where the power is. So when I get off of Scripture, then all of a sudden I'm not fulfilling my role anymore. I'm not fulfilling my role anymore. But the main thing is all of these things also then give us this great gift. It tells us and helps us to know about justification. It's just as if I'd never sinned. That we are declared not guilty in the eyes of God, and that we are declared righteous in the sight of God because of what Jesus Christ has done and who He is. Christ has also established offices, and the Holy Spirit calls workers into these offices as gifts to His church. It's kind of long. Let me read it again. Christ has established offices, and the Holy Spirit calls workers into these offices as gifts to His church. Again, these are not my words. Well, they are, but it's a summary of what we then have in these next couple of passages. And by the way, all of these, I could find multiple passages for all these concepts, but then we would be here way too long. So I'm giving you just sort of a summary. Ephesians 4:11-12. Christ also gave apostles, prophets, missionaries, as well as pastors and teachers as gifts to His church. Their purpose is to prepare God's people to serve and to build up the body of Christ. So who gives this gift? Christ does. And He gives apostles. And here I'm going to give you a little Greek lesson. No extra charge. Apostles, day is a word for and. It's often translated and. It's a weak form of and. So it can be translated as but. And you have to look at context when you're reading Greek to figure out, is this an and or is this a but? And so it says apostles, day prophets, day missionaries, as well as day pastors. And then it changes to kai. Now, chi only goes where things really do belong together, and there's usually a much more intimate connection between two things that are joined by chi. And so pastors and teachers, some scholars, and I agree with them, say that what this means is that pastors are also supposed to be teachers. This is like, we would maybe do pastors dash teachers or pastors slash teachers because pastors do both. They have the primary responsibility for teaching the gospel, teaching God's word, as well as shepherding or pastoring. That's what pastor means. It means to shepherd. And in context, it's usually a leader of souls, a leader of souls. So our job is to lead souls in the church of God. And by the way, in the previous passage, we talked about what are we supposed to do? Well, not only are we supposed to share God's word and baptism and the Lord's Supper, that's where the power is because that's where the word is, but all of those are to be used in order to prepare God's people, to equip God's people for works of service and to build up the body of Christ, to actually have it grow so that we end up with more and better disciples or apprentices of Jesus Christ. Acts 20:28 says this, "Keep watch over yourselves and all the flock of which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers." Overseers, the Greek word is the same word our word episcopal comes from. It literally means to oversee. Epi, over, and scopos, that's the word for scope, So like to scope things out, to see them, to hone in on something, but to overlook that. So it's a word that's used for managers. It's often translated bishop, which that's what a bishop is really supposed to do. But I like the literal translation, which is overseer. But that's a synonym then for pastor teacher, a synonym for pastor teacher. So keep watch over yourselves. So that's first. And then all the flock of which the Holy Spirit, who made you an overseer? The Holy Spirit, not yourself, not a congregation. The Holy Spirit did. It's a divine call. And be shepherds of the church of God, which he bought with his own blood. It doesn't belong to me. You don't belong to me. You know this. You belong to Jesus. But he has given me a divine call to be your shepherd, to be the one who pastors you and oversees the ministry of word and sacraments in this place. You know what this means? This means that, I got this from another source, it's not just me saying this, that the call of a pastor teacher, of an overseer, there's another word too, elder, presbyteros, that's a word that's also used interchangeably, we'll see it in a little bit when we look at Titus, with the word overseer or pastor. So elders and overseers and shepherds and pastors, they all mean the same thing. But this call is no less divine than the call that's received by the prophets in the Old Testament and the apostles in the New Testament. No less divine. It's talked about in exactly the same way in Scripture. In a divine call, the Lord does the calling. The Lord does the calling, the Father, the Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ. It's the voice of Jesus calling. But he does it through means. Just like he does with baptism, he uses plain old water, not special water, just plain old water. He uses bread and wine for communion to do amazing things, mysterious things. Well, he does that with the divine call too. He uses sinful human beings like me in order to share his word and share the good news that snatches people from hell and gives them life and forgiveness and freedom and freedom. So in a divine call, the Lord does the calling, but through human means, through congregations that do qualifying, worshiping, fasting, praying, listening to the Holy Spirit, electing, and ordaining. Now, we don't have one passage that has all those things in there, but we have multiple passages that say that these are things that typically happen within a call situation. Let's take a look. Well, hopefully you've had time to write all that down because it's a lot. But I wanted you to remember these things. That's why I asked you to write these things down, is to help you remember the things that usually go along with a divine call. They're human things. These are all things that we do, but they're important. Acts 1:23-26. The disciples determined that two men were qualified. How did they do that? They got to know them. They gathered information. That's kind of where we are in our process right now, using a district. Actually, it comes from the LCMS originally, and then our district has encouraged us to use the survey that we just talked about in our last hour. So we're in that process, first of all, figuring out who we are and what we need, And then we're going to look at qualifications of candidates next. So the disciples determined that two men were qualified. These men were Joseph, who was called Barsabbas and was also known as Justus and Matthias. Then they prayed, "Lord, you know everyone's thoughts. Show us which of these two you have chosen." Who chooses them? The Lord, right? You. The who is, the you is the Lord. "Show us who is to take the place of Judas as an apostle, since Judas abandoned his position to go to the place where he belongs." They drew names to choose an apostle. Matthias was chosen and joined the 11 disciples. Now, so Barsabbas and Matthias, as they were picking them, they specified that they had to be eyewitnesses of Jesus Christ. So that's part of their qualification in this particular case. They had to be eyewitnesses. Can't do that anymore, right? Because we don't see Jesus. But we hear his word, but we don't see him. But they had to be eyewitnesses. And that meant that they were with the disciples, because Jesus was, you know, they were with the disciples a good amount of the time, so they could be eyewitnesses as well. So they knew them well. They didn't, like, say, "Oh, let's just take lots and throw and see who wins, you know, or let's have an election and see who wins." They didn't trust blindly in the Holy Spirit, but they used human means and qualifications in order to determine what God's will was in this situation. And we do that too. We do that too. Acts 13, 1 through 3. "Now in the church at Antioch, there were prophets and teachers: Barnabas, Simeon called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manaen, who had been brought up with Herod the tetrarch." Wow, that's kind of highfalutin there. "And Saul. While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, 'Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them.' So after they had fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and sent them off." So in the Acts 1 passage, can you go back? I forgot something. Go back two. You just hit two, hit the back. There you go. One. There you go. You're there. Oh, actually, yeah, the Acts 1, 23 through 26. It's two more back, I think. Oh, there it is. Well, yeah, just one more back. So there's qualifying. The disciples determined. They prayed, and then they drew names. That's kind of like electing, but not. But, you know, they drew names in order to figure it out. Now we can go back to the Acts 13, 1 through 3. Sorry about that. My fault. Totally my fault. See, I'm sinful. But you already knew that. All right, so I'm sorry. Now the Acts 13. So it is one more back, I think. The Acts 13, 1 through 3. There we go. And so here you see they were worshiping the Lord, and they were fasting, and the whole, I guess this is on the next slide. One more. I'm sorry. Worshiping, fasting, and the Holy Spirit said. Now, how did the Holy Spirit talk? I don't know. Did he talk out loud? Did he talk through a person? You know, did a prophet stand up and say, "The Holy Spirit said such and such"? I don't know. Yeah, could be. Yeah, we don't know. And the important thing is to know that it's true. It happened. The Holy Spirit somehow guided this process and said, "Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul." He might have done it through an election. They might have cast lots. It does not tell us how they. Somebody might have spoken tongues, and somebody might have stood up and interpreted it. We just don't even know. But that's not the important part. The important part is it's Holy Spirit directed. It's not just human beings. Or the Spirit is working through sinful human beings to make his will known. That's the important part, and that's the thing we need to get. And it happened, again, not only with worshiping and fasting, but with praying, and then they ordain them. They lay hands on them and send them off. So there's ordination there, too. Acts 14, 23, finally. All right. "And when they had appointed elders for them in every church with prayer and fasting, they committed them to the Lord in whom they had believed." Now, the word "appointed" here is the Greek word kerotoneo. You know what kerotoneo means? It means to vote, to raise, to take a hand vote on something. So it means to take a vote on something. So it's an election. of some sorts. Again, we don't have details. And just because it's described this way doesn't mean we have to do it this way. It's not prescriptive. It's just simply describing how the early church did it. But probably, I mean, it worked really well in the early church. We should probably do something kind of similar. So, and get our lessons from it rather than making up our own stuff. So they showed hands, appointed elders for them in every church with prayer and fasting. So it wasn't just, okay, here are the qualifications, let's hire somebody. It was done in worship and prayer, seeking God's help, and then committing them to the Lord. Again, a type of ordination. And again, they knew the people, and so they asked and needed qualifications. They wanted qualifications. And Scripture has a couple of different places where it gives us qualifications for pastors, elders, overseers. So here we have Titus 1, 6 through 9. An elder must be blameless, faithful to his wife, a man whose children believe and are not open to the charge of being wild and disobedient. Since an overseer manages God's household, he must be blameless, not overbearing, not quick-tempered, not given to drunkenness, not violent, not pursuing dishonest gain. Rather, he must be hospitable, one who loves what is good, who is self-controlled, upright, holy, disciplined. He must hold firmly to the trustworthy message as it has been taught, so that he can encourage others by sound doctrine and refute those who oppose it. Now, I don't know if you're counting, but I did, and I came up with 18 different qualifications here. And this is not the only list. There's another list, long list, about 15 things. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verses 2 through 7. There are another big, long list of qualifications. And most of them are the same as what they are here. This is the most comprehensive one. And then there are little bits and pieces, as you read through the New Testament, of other qualifications that are listed on, well, not necessarily in a list, but mentioned along the way. So it is important to gather information first about ourselves, what are our needs, and then we also need to gather information about candidates and get as much information as we can. In the examples, most of the examples we have in Scripture, people knew these people. You know, they had been in the same congregations or in the same area, maybe walked with them, walked with Jesus like the disciples did. And so they already had a pretty intimate knowledge of the candidates. And so we need to get that information, as much information as we can, but still not with the idea that we know what's best, but leaving it in God's hands and looking for the direction from the Holy Spirit, from Jesus Christ, who ordained this and calls people in the first place. Around 1530, Martin Luther expounded upon the qualities of a good preacher. He did this in a sermon and contrasted those qualities with those of a preacher as the world would have them. So here's the thing. He's saying, this is what people in a congregation who are worldly would want. And this is kind of what our own sinful desires and flesh would want. And then this is what God would want. This is what a godly congregation would want. And he's going to contrast those. So first, as the world would have him, six things are necessary to the preacher. He must have a fine accent. He must be learned. He must be eloquent. He must be a handsome person. Sorry, guys. I think he struck out on all four of those. And then he must take no money but have money to give. How does that happen? You take no money but you give money. That's Luther's humor. He's a pretty funny guy, actually. He's being serious, but he's being funny. He must tell people what they like to hear. Now, that's the scriptural one, right? You know, that we're given. As sinful human beings, we crave people who tell us what we want to hear. We crave people who agree with us. We crave people who look like us, or maybe they're a notch better, you know, not too much better, but just a notch better than we are at all of these things. And we put pretty high expectations out there. I do. And now the true qualities of the good preacher, and there are more of them. One, he should be able to teach in a right and orderly way. He should have a good head. He should be able to speak well. He should have a good voice. He should have a good memory. This is why pastors eventually have to retire. He should know when to stop. There's Luther humor, but it's true. That's very important, knowing when to stop. He should be sure of his material and be diligent. He should stake body and life, goods and honor in this ministry. He should suffer himself to be vexed and flayed by everybody. Those last two are pretty sacrificial. He should stake body and life, goods and honor in his ministry. And Luther wouldn't ask anybody to do anything he didn't do. He did that in spades. And he must suffer himself to be vexed and flayed by everybody. So, it's important that we follow a careful process, and we're going to do our best to do that. And I think we've got a good start, good call committee, a good chairperson, and now it's going to be kind of up to all of us, praying, seeking God's will. The call committee will do the initial looking at all the different information we're going to get back from the district with the different people, but we need to do our best as a congregation to pray and ask for God's direction and guidance, and that he would protect us from looking at things in a selfish or human or worldly kind of way, but look for what's ultimately going to be best to build his kingdom. Because here's the truth. God works through us or despite us to accomplish his good purpose. And that's both kind of a threat as well as a comfort, right? The threat is, if we don't get it right, we're going to suffer, and people around us are going to suffer. If we don't do our due diligence, if we just do the selfish things, the things that sound right to us but are not informed by Scripture and what Scripture says, then we're going to end up in a worse place. But if we do due diligence, it doesn't necessarily mean that everything's going to go great from then on. I mean, Jesus did everything right, and look what happened to him. So there might be suffering and pain involved, no matter which way it goes. But here's the thing. Even if we get it all wrong, if we mess it up entirely, God is still going to work all things for good for those who love him. Now, in my own experience, I prefer to try to find God's way and stick to it, because I don't like suffering. And things work out better when I do that than when I don't. But at the same time, I do take comfort that when I make mistakes, and I make a lot of them, God somehow, in a mysterious, wonderful way, takes even the wrong turns that I've made and the bad things that I've done and uses them ultimately for good, for me and for his kingdom. So Romans 8:28, we know that all things work together for the good of those who love God, those whom he has called according to his plan. So it's a divine call, even though it uses a human prone to sin process, and we can get it wrong by looking for somebody who's going to tickle our ears and tell us what we want to hear. That's what happened with the Old Testament prophets, right? A lot of them just started saying what the people wanted to hear, and God said, "You're false prophets," and he struck them, and he struck the people who listened to them. I don't want to be struck. I don't want to look for somebody who's only charismatic, who's only good-looking, who's only got a great voice and a great preacher and a great leader and a visionary and is going to do all these great things for us. Ultimately, it's God who does the work, and he does it through his word and baptism and Lord's Supper, mainly. You know, we need somebody, I think, you know, as the three big ones that we talked about, who's good at youth and has gifts in leadership development, as well as, all of a sudden, the third one went away. Huh? And outreach. I think those are right on. I think that's where we need to go. And I didn't know that before we did that survey. I think that survey helped give us clarity about that. I mean, I had an idea, but I had no idea how strong that was going to be. So that's good. It's a divine but human process. Pastors, too. Pastors can get a call and accept them for selfish reasons. They might say, "Oh, they pay better, even though I better fit in where I am currently." Now, is pay something they should be thinking about? Yes, they have vocations as pastors. I mean, not just as pastors, but as fathers and husbands, and so they need to take care of their family, and so they need to make those decisions based upon their vocation as well as their occupation or their divine calling. But the overriding thing is, where can I best serve God's kingdom? Where do I best fit? Where do my skills and experiences best fit that congregation's needs and what they need in order to grow? And pastors sometimes get it wrong too. And some people run away from where they were because it's just uncomfortable and they want to be somewhere where they can be comfortable. And that's not always what God really wants them to do. Just look at Jonah. That's not really what he was supposed to do. It all worked out in the end, but that's not what he was supposed to do, is go off to a different place. Divine call, despite sin-prone human beings, is incarnational. This is just amazing to me, how God can take sinful Ken Michke and make him a pastor who speaks God's word. Luke 10:16, Jesus said to the disciples, "Whoever listens to you listens to me." Wow. "And whoever rejects you rejects me. But whoever rejects me rejects him who sent me." So Jesus is in what I say as I speak God's word. 1 Thessalonians 5:12 through 13. "We ask you, brothers, to respect those who labor among you and are over you in the Lord and admonish you, and to esteem them very highly in love because of their work. Be at peace among yourselves." You guys have loved me. I've loved our partnership in the gospel. This has just been a great 24 years of being with you and serving with you. And I'm looking forward to what God is going to bring in the future. And I know that you will love the next pastor that we add to our congregation just as much as you do me. And that's a great thing. That's a great thing. I look forward to what God is going to do through us all. Let's pray. Lord God, Holy Father, we thank you for your gifts of word and sacraments, pastors and teachers, direction and example, and your promise to work good through those gifts. We thank you for our guests and all who invited and brought them. We thank you for funds given to our building fund, for the blessings and resources you've entrusted to our care, and your promise to multiply them to build a bigger heaven and better lives. We ask you to inspire and empower us to declare the good news of the gospel and live the better life of Christian love, to receive his gifts through the preaching of the word, baptism, and the Lord's Supper, to follow the example of the early church as we prepare to extend a divine call, to trust in your promises, and to listen to you by listening to the one he sends us. We pray that you bless missionary pastor Nin and the people of Vietnamese Lutheran as they reach out to people in Sugar Land and beyond, that you would bless our attenders, community, state, nation, and world, that you would bless all leaders with your wisdom and move them to lead according to your will, that you would bless victims of violence, oppression, and disaster. We pray for repentance in America, for sobriety for those with addictions, that you would restore broken marriages, engage unengaged parents, heal broken families, and reconcile estranged family members. We pray for strength and faith and courage for family members to be saved. We pray for employment guidance and opportunities for Nancy, Jamie, and Dennis, that you would bless and protect our deployed troops and their families, especially Matthew. We pray for a safe pregnancy and delivery for Joy and Michael, Samantha and Jaden, that you would grant comfort and peace in their last days to Francis, Audrey, and Bernard, and that you would grant strength and rest to their families and caregivers. We pray that you would bless Cecilia and her family, that you would heal Jean. We thank you that she is now home from the hospital, and heal Neil, Susie, Robert, Carolyn, Alan, Adriana, Denise, Joyce, Clarice, Barbara, Erica, Marcia, Edna, Amber, Omi, Bethany, Daniel, Tracy, Baby Hendrix, Madison, Lee, Sandy, Ruth Ann, Kim, Iris, Alex, Benny, Lillian, Diana, Marianne, Carson, Clayton, Phil, Heather, Bud, Riley, Buster, Beth, Evan, Jeannie, Tanya, Rita, Walter, Colleen, Cindy, and Mario. And we pray that you would heal those battling cancer, especially Rhonda, Mark, Guy, Gino, Denise, Betty, Rhonda, Chris, Margaret, Shelby, Nava, Jesse, Devin, Pastor Ken, Laureen, Kathy, Maria, Meredith, Sebastian, Dave, Chuck, Robin, Adrian, and John. We pray that you would help those that we now name in our hearts and minds. and that you would open the hearts of people to the gospel and open our ears, hands, and mouths to bless them and to share Jesus with them. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and sing our next song.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful you shine.